Thank you to the Anita Borg Institute for the great honor of this recognition and for all of you for joining us. So supposedly when I was a very young child, someone asked me what I wanted to do when I grew up, and I answered, get my driver's license and my PhD. I owe the driver's license aspiration to my birthplace, Los Angeles, and my PhD aspiration to my parents, who are both academics, sitting over there, both with PhDs in electrical engineering, and, very importantly, both feminists. So it's not hard to answer the questions, how did I become interested in technology, who were my role models? I grew up surrounded by the ideals of pursuing science and engineering as a creative and stimulating way to have a positive impact on the world. When I think back over the last 30 of my 47 years, and after I get over the shock of those numbers, I do see a common theme of trying to make a difference through innovation and activism. As an undergrad at Berkeley, I was one of the charter members of Sheila Humphrey's Women in Computer Science and Engineering. Where are you, Sheila? And as a grad student at MIT, I was part of the group that wrote the Blue Book on the experiences of female computer scientists in academia, and one of the founding members of CPSR. During these same years, I also realized that while social concerns motivate me, what I really loved to do was to innovate and to be part of creating new technologies. And what a time it was to be part of the action. From the mid-80s when I finished my PhD, through the late 90s when I was a faculty member at USC and a researcher at ISI, the internet came into its own and the web emerged. I had the fortune of being part of the internet research community in its earliest days, and to work with people who were passionate and driven about the design of the TCP/IP protocol suite and the scalability and robustness of the global internet. Those years introduced me to the high of tackling messy problems that really needed to be solved and the perils of making problems messier than they need to be. The focus was on innovation and impact, not just publications. Towards the later 90s, the internet was so successful that I found it increasingly difficult to stay relevant while innovating. There was only one internet protocol suite, and it was important enough to the economy that innovation was generally managed quite conservatively, and probably appropriately so. So I launched a DARPA ISAT study at the time to explore networking of small, physically embedded wireless devices. And I should note that one of the things that inspired me to make the change was my then, I wasn't going to cry, was my then 9-year-old son, now 19, sitting over there, Josh, who seemed more interested in the stories I told him about other people's work than my own. As I spent more time in what we came to call embedded network sensing, I felt that as an experimental systems field, we really needed richer relationships with applications and real deployments, and I wanted applications that I could feel passionate about. On vacation in Costa Rica, I reasoned that the natural environment was a good candidate, perhaps even the killer app for wireless sensing. As it turns out, embedded network sensing has transformational applicability to a wide array of environmental and ecological problems, and the concreteness of these applications serve as excellent drivers for the technology. And of course, it's hard to think of anything more motivating or important than the state of our water, the impact of climate change, and the health of the environment in general. And perhaps some of the diversity and worthiness of these emerging applications will serve to attract more women to the field. So what lessons are there in here for others? Well, listen to your parents, seek inspiration from your children, and don't forget to go on vacation. Before concluding, I want to thank my parents for the strength of their expectations, my sisters, Margot and Judy, for their guidance, and my son Josh and lifetime partner Achi for giving me wonderful reasons not to work all the time.
Deborah Estrin, congratulations.